minus 20. 17 seconds, swing arm back. We have guidance internal. 10, 9, 8, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Come on. Listen, there's heavy security here. We've got stars in there. Are you going to the gig?
Aye.
Let's see your tickets. Come on. There's been a lot of forged these. I want to see them. Come on.
What
are
these
only forged? Aye. A lot of money lost.
You bought here 2 weeks
and ago. Yours. Very well, sir. Now I've got to show them to the boss.
You don't have seats numbered like that.
Is that it?
Zero. All engines running. Commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff. The program is in.
The world of pop music has been a multi-million dollar global industry for at least 30 years now. And Scotland was able to participate because here in Glasgow there was a venue capable of holding the supergroups for their live concerts. But after 12 years as Scotland's prestigious rock and roll theatre, the Glasgow Apollo bit the dust on June the 16th, 1985. During its lifespan, everybody who was anybody in the world of popular music played there. From Adam Ant to ZZ Top, to Johnny Cash, to Diana Ross, from Gary Glitter to Alice Cooper, even James Last, The Who, Cliff, The Stones, The Four Tops, and me. By the time I played here, it was already a legend, and after the gig, I understood why. Backstage was nothing much, but out front with that crowd, it was magic. It seems all the performers have kind words and fond memories of both the place and the audience. Paul McCartney. A giant in rock and roll. Lovely Tammy Wynette. The best in country music. The one and only Freddie Mercury from supergroup Queen. And David Soul, the singing cop.
The Apollo rightly gained a reputation, a personality perhaps. There's a lot of talk about magic when it comes to the Apollo. As if it was a living thing with its own special powers. Its relatively brief rock and roll history wasn't well documented, and soon people will be saying and believing all sorts of things about the place. Was it just bricks and mortar? It doesn't look much now as it stands here waiting demolition. Some people say it never did, and it well deserved the nickname it got towards the end, the Appalling. Well, this is what it looks like from the outside. Let's go inside. The doors have been closed for some months now, and it's freezing in here. It's also very, very dirty. And it's kind of sticky underfoot. There's a terrible smell. And we've got fungus growing on the ceiling up here. Not surprised, really. It's also very damp. It's just so sad seeing a theatre falling down like this. Here we are in the foyer. This is where they sold the ice cream and the peanuts and the programmes. And of course the tickets. Not much business there now though. And here's a poster for the last four concerts, finishing with the Style Council. I would imagine that the circle is somewhere over here. That's a poster for Uriah Heep. That must have been a fantastic night. All the glam, all the glitter, and all the grot, side by side. Well, over the years, as we'll see, there were lots of plans to make the Apollo's looks match its reputation as a top venue for the top stars. What's desirable isn't always financially or architecturally possible. So, in comes compromise. Inevitable, I suppose. Anyway, if you get too close, you can see the cracks beneath the makeup. It's a strange business, this. Some of us like to kid ourselves it's shadier and more dishonest than it is, or that maybe we know the real story, whatever that might be. Not many of us are keen to be quoted, but there's always one ready to sing.
Of course. I mean, this is all idle supposition and jealous tittle-tattle. Personally, I subscribe to none of these half-baked so-called theories. I mean, in this business, we all say things about one another all the time. Yet at the end of the day, we'll still go to rub shoulders together. You know what I mean? Don't get me wrong. None of this is intended as a personal criticism or anybody else in any way whatsoever. However, Apollo never really was what it seemed. It's never as posh a place as people might have imagined. I mean, even when he opened it for the first time, before it became the Apollo, when it was still the Greens Playhouse. Then he had to drape curtains and big sheets about in the foyer at the official opening to cover up the holes and the bits he hadn't painted. Even in my time, they said the Apollo was a jerry-built pig. One guy said, what was it? A Heath Robertson drawing in brick. Yeah? Never in its 50-odd years was maintenance its strong suit. Don't get me wrong. I mean, again, no blame intended or apportioned in any specific direction. There'd be rainwater coming down into dressing rooms. Four stories below the roof. Sewers would keep bursting. So you can see why some artists maybe didn't come to the Apollo that often. That's for the punters, eh? What did they get for their money when they thought they'd come to Mecca? Yeah, Mecca. You joke. But I'll tell you. Dirt. Broken seats. Freezing cold. Slime on the walls. Nest. Think. In fairness, so I mean, there were obviously problems for any management in just trying to keep things ticking over. Crowd, well, they just accepted the whole thing as part and parcel of the atmosphere of the Apollo. So really, it was no big deal.
At one point in the Apollo's patchy and patched-up career, there were plans to build squash courts or even a five-a-side football pitch inside its vast, unused spaces, to have deluxe dressing rooms and restaurants. Nothing ever came of them, though. I suppose the cost of keeping the place simply standing up or relatively watertight made anything else impossible.
We done quite a bit of upgrading, you know, when we were in the building to make the concerts easier, make the power easier for the gigs and things like that, you know. We're constantly working on it and trying to bring it up, but I mean, it was a great gig. I mean, you just didn't know where cables went, where fuses were, things like that. When something went wrong, it was murder.
If we were in upstairs downstairs, this would be the staff entrance, because I'm sure the public never came up this way. We could be near the top now, but you never can tell in this place. These offices tucked away above the stage used to be the headquarters of the Greens, the family that originally built the Apollo and ran it for 50 years. And these are all the financial files up here. You can tell we're in the movie industry because of these old reels and bits of film lying around all over the place. And who knows what we might find in some of these files. I don't know if you'll be able to see this, but I don't know if I'll be able to see it. It says, I herewith confirm the acceptance of your offer for £105 for the skating rink building at Somerton Road, Govan. £105 for a skating rink. A bit of a bargain, that. We'll have a look through here. It's a bit like a rabbit warren. It goes on and on. And who knows, we could be the first people to pass this way in 20 years. I'll have a look in here.
Now, these must be just some of the hundreds of architectural drawings that were made for the Greens Empire. Of course, many of these buildings were actually completed. Some have already gone. But just look how it's all ended up. It's hard to believe that the Greens saw this building as their flagship. But this place is so big that they were able to lease bits of it to other businesses without even noticing.
Fred Green, I shall always remember because he always wore the bowler hat. He used to take it off, put it on his desk. But whenever one saw him outside the playhouse, always around, he and his brother, Bert, too, and they were great characters, completely forthright. Fred Green was a remarkable man because he built the cinema into a place where the average working boy and girl could go to.
Herbert Green, who I think was the top man in it, he would get driven up to the front door with his walking stick, and he had his own personal guy on the lift, old Jimmy. He'd come out and help Herbert into the lift, and Herbert would disappear for the day. Then you see him getting back out at 5 o'clock. I don't really know what they'd done up there. I mean, maybe they just kept the cobwebs at bay.
Well, it says in the original plans that this is the Geneva room, the boardroom for the Green family. That fireplace is certainly impressive enough, except it's fallen in and collapsed like everything else. But this is odd. It's like a staircase coming up in the middle of the floor. It's been boarded over, and all the floorboards are rotten. The whole place is in decay. But here, embalmed in the carpet, is the original Green family motto. It's good, it's Greens. Really weird here, you know. It's a bit like discovering an old Egyptian tomb. It's a very strange place. A very strange lot. Time for an outbreak of history.
George Green was born into a Lancashire fairground dynasty, literally on the road. British cinema history tells us that the early moving picture industry moved around in fairground tents, such as Green's. Before his death in 1915, George Green had become a limited company with a chain of Scottish cinemas. His sons, Bert and Fred, opened Green's Playhouse on September the 15th, 1927. The auditorium itself had an audience of about 4,200. Up above that, there was a most elegant ballroom, and the Greens produced their own cinema adverts for it. The Greens Playhouse in Glasgow was for a time the biggest cinema in Europe. In spite of its size, it was built for the Greens by just a handful of their own workmen over 3 years and cost them £35,000.
Roll up, roll up, roll up, roll up for the unique Greens entertainment experience. Eee, by gum. Old Green used to make us work hard, you know. You sometimes never knew when you were going to get out of this place and go home. But long before the old bugger were either dead or limited, I remember folks saying that cinematograph were a 7-day wonder. Now, maybe they had a point, and maybe not. Old George always reckoned that the novelties a novelty. You can stake your living on that. It's all about giving Glasgow what it thinks it wants in the way of entertainment. Now, first it were the coconuts. Then we had wooden horses, dobby horses that went up and down and round and round. Goldfish that died. Do you remember you used to go and fetch them in your jam jar? And then we had our Green's newsreels, you know. Ah, with folk waving at camera as they got on the train for the holidays in salt coats. Aye, then the next week they come here and they see themselves on the screen. Ah, that screen. I remember the Jolson story, 1947, I think it was. Aye, they queued round the block for that, you know. And the famous Green's golden double divans. Do you remember them? It was the only place that young couples could get together for a kiss and cuddle in those days, you know. And they didn't have to watch the Jolson story, if you get me meaning. Oh, they'd be packed like sardines. Up there in the ballroom. Up there under this whole roof. Thousands of them. Dancing to Dr. Croc and his crackpots. Harry Gold and his pieces of eight. And you know, we used to get Joe Loss and his band every New Year's Eve. Ah, the entertainment business. And look at it now. They're either over here doing the boogie-woogie rubbish to somebody called the Rolling Stones. Who's this one? Dr. Ook. And Iron Maiden? Iron Maiden? I've never heard of the woman. And if they're not over here, they're across the road at the pavilion singing along with Sidney Devine. Or being hypnotised into being frogs by Robert Halpin. Ah, dear, you see, the main thing in this lark, the main thing in this lark is people. People. Because where there's folk, there's brass. Never let them know that you're treating them like muck and you're laughing. By God. Roll up!
In June 1973, Green's Playhouse signed off as a cinema. Up until that time, these letters had been hung outside and changed two or three times a week, according to the film that was showing. But never again would they spell out such names as Marilyn Monroe, Charlie Chaplin, Errol Flynn, Lon Chaney. They were taken down and put in this small room, and then the door was locked. 3 months later, a new era came. New sights, new sounds, and a new name. The Rockin' Apollo was born. But it wasn't quite as immediate as that. No story is ever that simple. Rock and roll and its attendant outrage had been easing its way into the Playhouse while it was still a cinema. In fact, it probably took hold before the screen came down. In May 73, David Bowie's concert had turned into a rock riot. The fans were bopping in the aisles and ripping out the seats.
Excuse me, my seat's broken. There's nails and everything coming out yet.
It's not my problem, darling.
What? There's no way I can sit in that seat. It's all broken.
I thought you crowd paid to scream, no sit.
Look, I waited 3 hours to get tickets for this. What?
Listen, darling, I'm a bouncer, not a janer.
Look, don't be rotten, mister. The seat's got nails.
Anyway, are you not a wee bit young to be here this time of night? Go on, beat it.
Hey,
don't push your luck.
Nor was the Playhouse that became the Apollo exclusively a rock and roll haven. Political parties hired it for rallies. Fight fans watched closed circuit relays of big boxing matches from America in the middle of the night. Perhaps it was fitting then that the new Apollo was christened by one of the last acts that was booked by the Greens, Johnny Cash. He played to the mums and dads, not the kids, but with two sell-out performances in September 1973. Excuse me. Oi! Excuse me. If you're looking for a job, would you try across the road?
Hey, I've moved and that's another broken seat I'm sitting on.
It must be catching.
Look, I paid money to get in here and that seat's broke.
Listen, it was probably you and your pals that broke the seats in the first place.
You're accusing us of breaking seats?
I'm not accusing you of anything. I'm telling you, if you get any more complaints, you're out.
Anyway, the person behind this new venture, the man who was prepared to risk everything for rock and roll, who just the year before had leased the ballroom upstairs and turned it into a disco, was Frank Lynch. He was head of the Unicorn Leisure Organisation, and the first manager under the new Lynch regime was Jan Tomasik.
He knew what they wanted, albeit that they didn't appreciate that they wanted it, and thus came about the Apollo Centre as well. where he was going to attract the top names, the established names in show business. Not necessarily in the rock field, middle-of-the-road artists, country and western, pianists, even to religious concerts, to the city, and give an opportunity of the people from the west of Scotland to have a venue where they could see their idols, locally.
What can we say?
And it is the only place to play in Glasgow.
I can't remember anything bad about the whole experience of playing there.
So I really look forward to playing there.
You know, you had to play the Apollo just to say you'd played it.
It became one of the most important venues in the world.
Well, I think it was the people that made it the success, the people who supported the artists who were visiting the venue. The only way I can describe it is standing with the security staff in the foyer, and we say, right, open the doors, and there was this mad rush of screaming, not necessarily Wayne's. They were there to see whom they wanted to see. And from that moment on, that atmosphere was carried right through to the hall. Well, the most terrific ones, and the ones that gave us always the greatest headache, were the Bay City Rollers when they were at their peak, because their audience were all 10 to sort of 13, 14 young girls, and to have them lying around the streets outside all night and trying to get them to buy tickets at 3 o'clock in the morning before 10 o'clock when the box office officially opened, but it would have made no difference. They wouldn't budge. They wanted to wait till 10 o'clock. It was part of the going to a concert at the Apollo to camp out overnight. And what we used to do was just make up instant powder soups and give them out in plastic cups to those in the queues just to keep them warm. It was another one of Frank's fads, if you like, for looking after the people who were supporting what he saw as being the future in entertainment in the city.
The 70s were the Apollo's peak, the time in which its reputation was made. In a 12-month period during 1976 to 77, the Apollo staged a record run of 128 shows, 75% of which were sold out. 100% sellout, and it had to be 100%, not a single unsold ticket, earned the artist concerned a statuette from the Apollo management. These statuettes were much prized, as you can see. Sometimes the roadies were so keen for their stars to get a statuette that they'd run around and buy up the last couple of tickets just in case. Incidentally, the statuettes cost the Apollo all of £7.50.
Well, it was always kind of a highlight of every British tour we did in Roxy. Was going there because the audience was so warm. It was always amazing, even before you went out on stage. And we could hear them in the dressing room sort of banging away, the whole building moving. And they were also kind of very appreciative of the music when you play. I mean, they kept quiet when you were doing a quiet song and so on. And then they would erupt at the end, which is the perfect kind of audience. Some buildings have that sort of a good atmosphere anyway. And that building was particularly pleasant to be in.
I don't think there are any other people in any other part of the British Isles that would actually sit in such a disgraceful, disgusting, filthy place to go and see the bands and the people that they really want to support. The Apollo, if it had been maintained and looked after, still could have the magnificent ballroom, it still could have probably the top balcony. There's so much space and things behind stage. They could have built nice dressing rooms. They could have built, I mean, there's no place even that the kids could have bought it, buy a sandwich or have a drink in there. They could have built nice, but they could have really made that place something very special.
I think Glasgow, it was a very special gig. I mean, it was always a gig like Newcastle was another one that you could always rely on it being a special night. Some gigs, you know, I mean, London was always patchy because sometimes you get a very blasé audience in London. Whereas in Glasgow, you always felt they were so pleased to see you that they would always, you know, all you had to do was do what you did the best you could and they'd always enjoy it. And I've never liked the sight of the dress circle going up and down 9 inches when you're actually, especially when you're on a level with it, you're seeing these kids go up and down, you think, God, you know, there's about 2,000 kids down there, and there's 1,000 kids going to jump on top of them in a minute. The dressing rooms downstairs were always a bit, in the old days, I mean, we played there pretty much year in, year out with Genesis up until about 75, 76. In fact, we played there in 76. And then we probably had a break from doing any English tours till 1980. But we always played there. And it just, the facilities got a little nicer. There's television in the dressing room. wallpaper on the walls, things like that.
On the Unicorn days as well, I saw the change from greens to the Apollo, when they covered the place in glitter and, you know, refurbished the whole thing. They dyed the It's Good, It's Green's carpet, which is wonderful. I'd love to have some of it. It's wonderful carpet. It was all specially made for them. They had tons of it upstairs somewhere that had never been used. So they dyed it all, so different colours and things. And I remember the refurbishment well.
I mean, it might sound as if I'm a sort of hygiene fanatic, but I wouldn't stand on the carpet because it was always wet. And it was much too fierce, you know, to talk about. I didn't quite know what it was, but I didn't want to stand on it. So when I do my quick changes, you know, when everything comes off and I'm standing there in my little bare feet, I used to stand on a towel rather than stand on the carpet. It was just hideous. I wouldn't use the loo.
We had a good one there, actually. The stage has really got to be the highest stage in the world. And, of course, we used to tell all the American nights, because that's because of the Glasgow punters, pal, you know. I mean, you've got to keep them back, you know. And we played there one night, and there was two guys actually made it onto the stage. I don't know how they did it. And the bouncers were going to throw them off, and we were saying, no, give them a prize. How did they get up there, you know? And they did. They made it.
From an atmosphere point of view, it was always very special. I think it was special for every band that ever played there. I mean, at our real height in 1973, I mean, we used to have to get in and out of the theatre in with police escorts in police vans and everything. It was real heady days, those. Good, though.
It's the only time in my life that I've actually been booed on. I mean, I should have... And because the Apollo was like that, it was a watershed in a lot of people's careers. I know a lot of people who never played again after they played the Apollo.
They were always very enthusiastic. It was always a sort of a good gig, and it was always a good place to play because there was sort of a terrific energy coming from the audience.
Terrible. Glasgow Apollo holds more people than the Brixton Academy, which is like over 4,000 people under one roof, right? So it's all got a lid on it, right? And you got all these people, 4,000 people, you know, these hideous, spotty cavemen in RAF overcoats banging their heads on the seats in front, you know, and they hated me. It's very extreme experience to have 4,500 people hating you all at the same time.
You know, I never believe a word anybody in this business tells me about anybody else in this business. I mean, if you even listen to half the stuff that people say about other people, you'd start thinking that everybody that ever sang a song or sold a ticket was either a raging poof, front for a mafia, junkie, chronic alcoholic, had a colostomy. I mean, this is all total nonsense. And I'd be very, very cheery about repeating any such gossip. However, in the Apollo's early days, two artists, both of whom came for the States, as it happens, gave very similar shows. In short, bloody rotten shows. The first guy, he was hailed as the godfather of punk, or whatever. And for the sake of no being sued, I'll call him Lou Dear. So anyway, this block gets led on stage, propped up against a mic stand, mumbles his way through half a dozen songs as though he's just waking up for a bloody nightmare, and the audience love him. Oh, more, more, bravo! Go on yourself, Jimmy. The second guy, whom we will call Neil Younger, he comes on drunk. He forgets the words to his songs, has to abandon a couple of them, ends up going off early under a barrage of abuse that would fell a elephant. The first one, you see, he was known to be a bit of a, well, dopehead. He acted the way everybody thought he should. The second he'd banger, he was just meant to come on and sing in the kidney. It's all about getting an audience what they think they're going to get. Should be pointed out, however, both these artists are... both these artists are usually entirely dependable. Real trippers. Certainly no wish to impugn the professional integrity of my showbiz colleagues and practitioners. Know what I mean? Some of these guys do shows for charity.
We've had a lot of nice people playing here, you know. I mean, look at the Jacksons. A nice bunch of lads by all accounts. But they didn't play here. 1977, I think it was. Can't remember now why they didn't come. Anyway, we had one of those telegrams, didn't we? To say that they weren't coming on the day that they were supposed to be here. Which wasn't much use to this party from Stonehaven. You see, they'd set off overnight in the minibus. And when they got here, you see, the manager over at the pavilion kindly offered them free tickets for the pantomime. Jack and the Beanstalk. Michael Jackson. Jack and the Beanstalk. Well, it's all show business, isn't it? There's no business like show business. There's no business I know.
Is there something special about a Glasgow audience? Or is it just that they think they're special? Surely it's only a Glasgow rock and roll audience that would boo somebody off. I mean, the mums and dads at a regular theatre like the Pavilion are a bit more polite, aren't they?
I certainly don't agree, because if they've ever done a Saturday second house in a Pavilion in Glasgow, you'll see a really wild audience, you know what I mean? You're halfway through the act and somebody shouts, "Get the singers back on!" You know, you're fighting then, that's you, you're on a downward slope and it's getting slippier all the time. But they're, in the main, they were a good audience, you know, but you get wild ones.
And there's nobody better than a Glasgow audience. There's no audience better because they really let you know how much they appreciate you. But I should think, I would hate to be one of the people that they don't like, because I think they'll let you know that as well. I've heard, you know, there's always those famous stories about throwing things at Frank Sinatra and stuff like that, you know, I can't believe it. But
a great tradition of Scotland and the whole of the United Kingdom has been the live entertainment. I mean, I long to come to Scotland at least once every year or maybe every 2 years, because I know I'm going to get a wonderful, happy audience. Maybe a slightly heckling audience, but it's all done in goodwill.
Being an audience, say, going to the Pavilion, you had to stay in your seat and everything in it, and the show was lovely. And getting into the Apollo, I think it let the sort of Glasgow spirit out, wherewith they went clamped down to the seat and they could stand up and go, "Hey!" shout or do anything that they wanted to do. And I feel it was a sort of freedom for the public going to the Apollo.
In 1977, bang, we had the sudden arrival of a different type of pop performer and a different type of audience. People who didn't seem to be happy with anything. Punk rock and punk rockers. It wasn't quite as shocking as it thought it was, and they didn't change things quite as much as they hoped they would.
In Glasgow, they attracted the heavy metal audience, right? And at that point, which was 1977, kind of, whenever heavy metal fans and punks got in the same vicinity, all hell broke loose, you know. So it was rather a foolhardy thing for me to do, to appear on that particular bill at Glasgow Apollo. And in fact, it was part of a tour. And throughout the whole tour, the road crew were saying, "I can't wait to see how you go down in Glasgow."
Nevertheless, the business was changing, and the Apollo was changing too. Principally, Frank Lynch's relationship with the Green family was about to shift. His lease on the Apollo was nearing its end, and unicorn losses had been mentioned. The rental, it was inferred, was too high. The rock business was no longer a license to print money. Steps would have to be taken, it was inferred, to ensure a more regular day-by-day income. A different type of paying customer, perhaps. Enter, in 1978, a new and terrible threat to the Apollo's rock status.
Bingo, as Apollo Pop fades.
Apollo Bingo would kill rock concerts.
Rock fans get blues over Apollo numbers.
Is it curtains for the Apollo?
The younger generation knew where they stood. Two 15-year-old Glasgow schoolgirls originated the petition which drew up the battle lines in the fight to save the Apollo.
It was one of the few places that we could go to see bands playing.
We wouldn't have had any nightlife at all if the Apollo had closed down at that time.
There were 18,000 names in the petition as far as I can remember. And they were mainly just names we collected in the street. We used to go to Buchanan Street Precinct and just ask anybody that passed by.
But frankly, I mean, these days, it's all about cash flow, ain't it? Rock and roll, bingo, whatever draws them in. Know what I mean? I mean, it wasn't as if it was some sort of death sentence, was it? A High Court judge sticking on the black cap and saying, I hereby sentence the Apollo to cease playing all that evil, loud music. Become a quiet wee bingo hall.
No. What are you supposed to do in a
Personally, I think that a lot of the people who made a fuss and got involved in all the debate just like to hear the sound of their own voices. Yeah. I mean, there are these guilt-stricken Scottish tax-exiled rock stars living in bloody Beverly Hills or whatever, peeing about and patronising us.
Us guys, we've got to save the place. It's important.
Then it was this motley crew. Radio 1, disc jockeys.
Pushes to the Apollo Theatre up there in,
Along with all your trendy wee ministers for the Church of Scotland, prattling about.
Where are these children going to go, I ask?
And the tartan Tories, the SNP.
It's a national disgrace.
Looking for votes
and
as usual.
Again.
Oh, aye. And the ruling Labour Council, they're trying not to say anything at all. In case it costs some money if somebody asks them to take the Apollo off. The only support for bingo came from Eric Morley.
First order, it's rock, roll, and finger.
Your usual bampot councillor saying, these rock and roll vandals should find a field for themselves in their horrible noise outside the city. Ah, I mean, there's a lot of free publicity for everybody. At the end of the day, it's about cash flow. Yeah, you got it.
The battle against bingo was won, but slowly the war to save the Apollo was lost. Amid some speculation, some tears, some popping champagne corks, the Apollo closed on July the 6th, 1978, with a special concert by Unicorn Leisure's cabaret star, Christian.
Oh yeah, it was a mixture of joy and sorrow. You could feel that, even though you couldn't sort of really see your audience, you could feel that coming over the lights, this sort of... Yeah, it's great to be here, but we're sorry, it's dying.
Well, was it closed for the summer? Or merely closed for renovation? Or had it been shut for good? On September the 29th, 1978, the Apollo reopened with Tom Robinson. It survived for a further 7 years, permanently surrounded by rumours of impending doom. Although nobody knew it for a fact, the end was now inevitable, and the process of degeneration was accelerated by the departure to America of the man whose vision had founded and guided the Apollo for its first 6 years. In 1979, Frank Lynch left.
After about 4 or 5 years, the place was in need of a renovation, and it would have cost maybe £250,000-£300,000 to do this. And I just felt that the economic climate in Scotland at that time wouldn't make this investment viable. And I was already contemplating leaving the country anyway, so I felt it would be better just to wind it down rather than run a shabby place.
In March 1980, George Green Limited sold the Apollo for £1.5 million to Maximus Investments, the owners of a string of British theatres, who eventually became Apollo Leisure.
The new owners promised to spend another $1.5 million on a modernisation plan. Then Glasgow Licensing Board refused the Apollo a liquor licence. A £20,000 subsidy from the council was applied for to keep the place going. Amid much argy-bargy, it was approved, refused, approved again. Isn't it funny how when you're having a good time, you sometimes just don't notice some things?
You know, there was a whole crowd of us used to go, and we all sort of liked the same type of music, and we went for the same reasons. It was it was a night out. B, you were going to see a band who were going to produce something spectacular every time and be different every time. They were never, you know, they didn't just stand there. They went out and out of their way to give a performance.
When the Police came, not that long ago, when they were really huge, 1981, thereabouts, the Police came, and I could only get into the balcony, the very top balcony. And they went into, I think it must have been Don't Stand So Close to Me, maybe Message in a Bottle, one of those anyway, and the place erupted. And that balcony, sitting in it, it must have been bouncing 6 feet. It felt like it. I don't care how many civil engineers or experts tell me it's safe, I would never have gone back into that balcony again.
Well, the audience, to put it in a nutshell, went absolutely crazy when the Jam played. It was certainly the most lively concert I think I've ever been to. Some danced, some broke bottles over other people's heads, and some generally tried to invade the stage and gain access to the stacks of amplifiers that were on the sides.
It has been a happy place for us to be in, although we are older than the groups that were there. And we found them all very interested. Us interested in them and all their gear, their hair, their styles, whatever they were dressed in, made no difference. They were interested in us. They would amble over and say, "What are you, Sally Army?" "No. Traffic wardens?" "No. We're first aiders for St Andrew's Ambulance." "Oh, aye. What do you get for doing this kind of thing?" "Well, we really don't get very much for doing this, except maybe sometimes a lot of cheek, a lot of pleasure, or whatever."
I ended up with two guys and a girl coming up with their backpacks, a la Himalayas, everything else, parkas, a wet night, got in, I went and I looked and I said, "Oh, heavens, another 50 pence short of going to Queen Street Station, as was the usual in these days." And what in actual fact happened was take us to the Apollo. Got round to the Apollo, I said, "Well, 50 pence, thank you very much." Going like that and saying, "Good grief, here we go again." And they went like, "No, we don't want you to leave. We're here to get tickets." The big, big queue, of course. I said, "Oh, that's fine, but I said, the tickets don't go on sale until tomorrow lunchtime or something." "Oh, we want you to stay. You'll be our base, and we'll just change in here and we'll have the kit out." I said, "What's the gear?" "Oh, we've got all our camping and cooking gear and everything else, so we're here for a long stay."
The first time I went to the Apollo was in 1972 to see Deep Purple, would you believe? And I still got my ticket stub. I was in row L, seat number 13. And I had to borrow a denim jacket to go because all I had was a Barathea blazer and I didn't think I looked very cool headbanging with a Barathea blazer. So I borrowed this jacket and I went, and it was one of the most exciting days, or evenings rather, of my life. It was just like, it was like being at a football match where everybody supported the same team. And it was tremendous when I came out. I mean, I can understand how, you know, when girls used to go and see the Bay City Rollers and things like that, how they would be totally drained. I was completely drained because I had been playing a metaphysical guitar for 2.5 hours, and, you know, it was tremendous.
The Lou Reed tour. Now, there we had yourself, your hero from early on, you know, sort of Velvet Underground and all that. And then he came on stage and you couldn't believe this guy. He was just all over the stage, and then eventually he just gave up. He just sat on stage and drone to the audience, and he was brilliant.
I think just about everybody that's played the Apollo has come back two or three times, or would like to have come back to play the Apollo again, without exception. A lot of people think these stars are untouchable, but they're very, very down to, well, the bulk of them are down to earth, and really down to earth. They're just like friends of yourself.
In 1981, Paul Gregg was the boss of Apollo Leisure, and he hinted that this place might soon be finished because there was a possibility of another venue in the city. 8 weeks later, in desperation for a way to keep the place open and money coming in 7 days a week, Greg put films back on. And though the planners had given permission in 1982 to demolish the place, somehow the management kept it going until 1985.
In most areas, of course, theatres are helped one way or another financially, either by trusts from public money or actually directly by the local authority. So we went to see the authorities in Glasgow, and I have to say they were very helpful. I mean, I really felt they were interested and they did care, and they did see it, that it was somewhere where the young went. It was a legendary building, and they wanted it to survive, but they only wanted it to survive until their own Scottish Exhibition Centre opened.
We would have loved to have come along here and spend £5 million and make it into a theatre. You would have then been, I'm quite certain, the best theatre in Great Britain. Of course, if you can do all aspects of entertainment, certainly today you can't specialise in one. You have to be able to provide all kinds of entertainment, the opera, the ballet, the pantomime, conferences, cinema, anything really.
But things stumbled on until June and the very last gigs. Would it all end with Dr. Hook on June the 6th? No, it staggered on until June the 16th, and the show with the Style Council. Even on that night, there were conflicting rumours amongst the staff. Either there was still a grand finale to be organised, or the demolition would start in 2 days. Amid all the talk and speculation, commemorative TV and radio, reflective interviews, articles looking back, or indeed looking forward to the debut of the replacement for the Apollo, the new Scottish Exhibition Centre, the Apollo itself gave up the ghost.
Status quo. They were the ones, you know. They always went down to bomb here. I remember one afternoon we had them buggers round from the Environmental Health. They came round during a sound check, you see, and they had all these little meters, you know the things, to monitor the sound. Anyway, Quo got stuck into something, you know, like a... big and loud, you see. And you could see all these officials, you see, going to a little huddle. And they got all excited and they were practically rubbing their hands. They thought they'd got them this time. Anyway, one of them goes over to the manager and he shows him the meter. 93 decibels. Bloody loud. And he was expected to say, it's a fair cop, we'll all come quietly. But instead, he just said, wait until tonight, pal. Because he used to speak like that, you see. Anyway, comes the night, quote, blasting to the same song, and the same reading, 93 decibels. And when they'd finished, I remember the crowd started roaring. And the bloody needle nearly jumped off the box. I've never seen folk looking so fed up as those sound inspectors. They looked as if they'd lost a quid and found a shilling. You see, status quo knew what this place was all about. Loud, hot, electric, straightforward, and no nonsense. And that's the way it always should be. Ain't that right?
Well, I've got to own up. It was pretty much a favourite gig. I mean, there was something about that, that when you got up there, I remember the first time we did it, we were frightened. I was going to say shitting ourselves.
You were going to say shitting, yeah, I know you were, yeah.
We were pretty frightened because the Glaswegian audience, they're known for their
friendliness?
Yeah, you get out on that stage and if they don't like you, you know, they really don't like you. So we had something to prove when we got out there, you know. And I think we have over the years. It's been a favourite gig of ours, a great crowd. They don't like him, though. It's the only drag.
No.
They've never taken to Rossi up there, you know.
You see, bands like Status Quo, I've nothing against them. It's just that, personally speaking, they're not my cup of tea. I mean, I prefer something a wee bit more sophisticated, you know. But, if that's what people want, and they do, don't they? Well, who am I to argue? I mean, the fact of the matter is that Status Quo and the Apollo were made for one another. They shoot at one another perfect. Quo were very traditional in their own way. Oh, filling. What a player, porridge or plum duff. Yeah. And the cool crowd knew their part in it. They were meant to stand where they stood. The cool would jump about, shaking their hair. What a crowd had today was buying their heads together and everybody was happy. Don't get me wrong. I mean, Cole weren't rotting any boats. They weren't laying down challenges. And nobody in the crowd was going to go on the score. Not like some of the punk characters. Yeah. At the end of the day, your ears were buzzing and your jeans were manky. That proved you had a good time.
Okay, what about a few facts then? A live LP by Status Quo. Billy Connolly, 12 sellout shows inside 14 days. And that live LP by the Rosillos. Of course, there were plenty of other live tracks. There was Alice Cooper, Roxy Music, Nils Lofgren. You know, I was always sure he'd break his neck when he came off that springboard. There was Loudon Wainwright, and there was that gig by some Irish Republican band called the Wolf Tones when the audience went barmy and gave the Apollo a £7,000 bill for damages. Seems that lots of demolition dates were suggested. They all came and went. And I wonder who's got the three missing visitors books with all the autographs in. And what about Johnny Cash's jacket? Who's got that? Now there's talk of yet another demolition date.
Well, here come the kids. Bunch of animals.
Well, it's finally over then. Are we really supposed to believe that nobody cares? Are there no protests? Are there no petitions this time? It seems that nobody wants any more. Whatever it was the Apollo provided.
Well, what am I supposed to say? That I'll miss this place. No way. Listen, this used to be a great place for slogans. Everybody used to go on about bums and seats. That was the only slogan that mattered. Well, I'll give you a slogan. There's no bums, no seats. And definitely no danger of a touching farewell. Place has been slowly dying for years. The key word was always cash flow. Yeah. And yet the Apollo went down the drain. It's the Apollo, it's a goner. The Apollo. Rock and roll. Atmosphere. Well, if it's no deed of dying, it certainly smells funny.
So, what are we supposed to do? Watch our rock and roll at home on TV? You know, like swap video for live performance? Or maybe we're supposed to be content to nip down to the exhibition centre and watch long range through our binoculars? Wither, if you'll allow us a moment for philosophy. Wither rock and roll.
Saturday night, I got married. Me and my wife settled down. Now
Well, it's coming down, you know, that's what we're doing now. Take another stroll downtown.
Why not? Have you seen a Portland guy?
What a Portland guy you get in there.
There. Open.
So what's all this performance then? Who's been making all this noise? You're the cover photo, aren't you?
Yes, it is.
There's all this going on over here. You're just the same part of it.
On stage, hold back two ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Is this your mother? Again, good luck.
Well, they're all the way to get on with their job, and there's something I've got to do before I go.
It's sad to have to meet for this, isn't it?
Very sad, the end of an era.
Yeah,
right. Could I ask you to do the final ceremony?
Yeah, certainly will. Well, that's it then. Yeah, bye, Jim.
Bye,
nice to see you. Good luck.
Bye, Albert.
See you again. Bye. See you again. Oh, hello, sunshine. See you again. Ta-da.